assistant professor of electrical and electronics department from Sai Vidya Institute of Technology. Today I am going to explain the experiment of the load test on a three-phase induction motor. Why do we conduct this test? Because in order to find out what will be the effect of the performance of the induction motor when we are going to load it. So what is our main aim of this experiment is to conduct the load test on a given three-phase induction motor and to plot its performance characteristics. What is the performance characteristics? We are keen to know about the what will be the change in the performance of induction motor when you are going to load it. So the characteristics which you are going to draw in this experiment is the x-axis we are going to take it as an output in BHP, that is a brake horsepower, versus the remaining parameters. What are those remaining parameters? Is how it is going to affect onto the efficiency, how it is going to affect onto the torque and slip, and as well as the power factor. So these are the performance characteristics which you are going to obtain by conducting this test. So to conduct this test, before that we should know the some part of a theoretical knowledge, that is when the induction motor is on no load, right? So when the induction motor is on no load, the speed of the motor will be slightly less, or it will be slightly less than the synchronous speed, that is denoted by LS. In general, we know this, right? So that is at no load, we will find that the rotor will rotate with the speed which will be slightly less than that of LS. When you are going to see that, when you are going to load it, so when you are going to load it, then we will find the speed will be further, it will be reduced. It will be further reduced. So that will be the effect on the speed. So this is what we can drop out to the different key parameters, where and not it is going to affect on to the different parameters when you are going to load the motor. Okay. So therefore we will find that when the load is increased, we will find the speed is further reduced. Similarly, we can also find out what will be the effect on the slip. So as we know that, how do we define a speed? Slip. Slip is nothing but it is a relative difference between the two speed. So that is the synchronous speed and the rotor speed. Right? So this is synchronous speed is nothing but it is a the speed of the RMF. Speed of RMF. And this is the speed of the rotor. So when you take the ratio of this between the two relative speed, ns minus n divided by ns into 100, that gives you the slip, that is percentage yes. So as I told you, when you increase the load, the speed of the rotor will decrease. Due to this, keeping in mind the synchronous speed is kept as a constant, so the difference of these two will keep increasing. So due to that, the slip value will also increase. So this is about the effect on a slip. Similarly, you can also go through one more effect, that is effect on a power factor. So before we go with the effect on a power factor, we should know what will be the effect on a stator current. Because the current is usually decide the nature of the power factor. Right? So therefore here, as on no load, we will find that the power factor value will be very less. Why? Because the magnetizing current value will be more. What is this magnetizing current? Is because when the stator at a no load, we know that when there is a no load, the stator current will be composing of two components. One component is the magnetizing component, which is responsible to produce a rotating field, and another component is nothing but the component which is equal and opposite to that of a field, which is going to produce a torque. So that is another component. So here on no load, we will find that the power factor value will be less due to because the IM, that is a magnetizing current value, will be very high. So when you are going to load it, the motor, okay, then what will happen to the change of the power factor? The power factor will also increase. Why? Because as we will find, the rotor current increases and the stator current increases. So due to this, as I told you, the current is mainly depending onto the factor or the deciding the nature of the power factor. So therefore, as the current value increases, definitely the power factor will also whole square. So as the slip value increases, definitely the torque value also increases. So these are all the changes of the effect on the performance of the induction motor. That is what we are going to plot it there at the end after the calculations. So this is about the theory. Now coming to the what type of the machine which you are going to use. So let us see that what are the main details of the machine which you are going to use. So the type of a machine which you are going to use is three phase induction motor with a rated output of the machine as 5 HP and the rated speed is 1440 rpm and the rated voltage is 415 volts and the rated current is 7.5 ampere. So we have to remember the main thing is about this the rated current, because since this is a load test we need to vary the load in such a way that it should not exceed to this rated current. So this is a maximum allowable value by which the machine can carry this current under a normal circumstance. If you go beyond this, the machine can get damaged. Now let us move on to the circuit diagram. Before that, what are the components we require to rig up the circuit? So here you can see the apparatus required is, we require an ammeter of 0 to 10 amperes, quantity is 1, and the voltmeter is 0 to 600, quantity is 1. Why do you prefer this 0 to 600 is because this is a 3 phase. So we should have above 415 volts range. So we should prefer 0 to 600 volt. And why do you prefer this ammeter as 0 to 10 amps? Because the rated current is around 7.5. So it should be more than that. So to measure the current, so we are going to prefer the 0 to 10 amps. And as well the power, that is wattmeter. Wattmeter we are going to prefer as a unity power factor, that is UPF wattmeter, which is of the range which ammeter, that is 0 to 10 amps only, that we are going to prefer due to the rated current. And 0 to 600 due to the rated voltage. This is how we can decide the which wattmeter we have to prefer. Next, the kit which you are going to use is 3 phase induction motor. So let us draw the circuit diagram in which we are going to consider into the 3 different sections. First section is under the wattmeter section. So we are going to write down the wattmeter connections here. So another part of it, we are going to make use of the 3 phase induction motor, how does it looks like. And the initial, the first part will be the supply, right? So let us first draw the wattmeter. So as we are going to use 2 wattmeters, so you can remember the 2 wattmeter connections as we have done in the previous semesters. So here you can see the wattmeter will be consisting of the 4 terminals, that is nothing but M, L, C, V. So this will be the W1 and this will be the W2. So in this case, this is about the arrangement of the wattmeter, and as all you know that in the 2 wattmeter method we will be connected together. So this is about the wattmeter connections. And next, coming to the part, we are going to draw the induction motor. So how do you draw that induction motor, which is denoted by the delta type of a connection, that is R, that is A1, A2, and since I don't have the Y connection, Y phase, this will be the Y phase, that is C2, and this will be C1, and another phase will be the B connection, so that will be the B1 and B2. So this will be the stator arrangement, and inner to this we'll be having a rotor. So this rotor is being directly being coupled to this brake drum arrangement. So here we will provide, we will see that how you are going to vary the load by making use of this brake drum. So in this brake drum we'll be having a parameter, that is F1 and F2, which is indicating about the weights, how much you are going to apply, and we can able to calculate the torque of this machine. Okay, so this is about the F1 and F2, the brake drum arrangement by using the spring balance. And this is one the third part of a circuit. And first part of a circuit is we have to make use of a starter. So to start this induction motor, we require a 3 phase dual starter. Dual means three phase dual starter. Dual means direct online starter. Direct online starter. So in this direct online starter, we'll be having the both the sides input and the output terminals. So as here the output, let us connect it off the output part. So here you can see that this output part can be directly connected to the main, that is M stands for main of a battery W1, and similarly the another part of this can be connected by making use of the blue color, since we have a three phase. So R, Y, V, we are going to make use of the arrangement. Okay, and one more terminal will be left out here. So this I'm going to make use of one ammeter. So that ammeter, which will be of the range of 0 to 10 amps, so which is to be connected directly to this part. Okay, similarly the other side also you can continue. So this L should be connected to this part, and this L stands for load, so that will be connected to this part. So this is how we can perform the connections after the output of a dual starter. Next, coming to the input of a dual starter, we will find once again there will be a RYB phase, so that will be connected to the input switch, right? So that will be, there will be a protective mean by the fuse, so where we can indicate this, and further we can connect it. So this will be the input side which you can find out, and this will be the R phase, Y phase, and Y phase, and B phase. So what will be the range of this voltage, the input voltage? That will be around 3 phase 415 volts AC supply. Okay, so this is how we can write down. And also you can specify what is the W1 and W2. So W1 and W2, which you are going to prefer, is the UPF wattmeter. UPF wattmeter with a having a range of 0 to 10 amps and 0 to 600 volts, because it is a three phase. So this is how we can refer the two batteries. So what is about the procedure? So procedure is here. Yeah, one more thing. What you can do? One more additional. You can add up the voltmeter across this. Okay, so we have to check out. Okay, one, this is used, this is used, this has been used. We are left out with the voltmeter, which is around 0 to 600 volts. Okay. Now, coming to the procedure, initially we have to make ensure this belt has been loosened. So that means we are not applying any load. So F1 and F2 value will be 0. F1 and F2 value will be 0. Okay. And here we are going to see that we will switch on the supply by making use of this dual starter, and we are going to note down the readings of the wattmeter W1, W2, ammeter, voltmeter, and as well F1 and F2, which is equal to 0. So that will be the no load readings. Okay, then we need to load the motor. How to load the motor? By increasing the F1 and F2. By increasing the F1 and F2 by another 1 ampere, in steps of 1 ampere, we can note down what are the readings which can be provided by W1 and W2. Suppose now when we are going to take the readings of a two wattmeters, if any one of the wattmeter kicks back, we need to interchange the terminals C and B. That is a voltage coil. We have to interchange the terminals C and B. Then we have to note down the value. That value will be taken as a negative reading. Suppose now during the loading test, again when the wattmeter is going to kick back, then once again we need to interchange the C and B connection, and we can take up that reading value will be as a positive for the same wattmeter if that wattmeter shows in that way. Okay, like that we have to note down the readings. That will be a loaded reading. So further you have to take down the corresponding F1 and F2 value. Similarly, again we have to load the motor by increasing the F1 and F2 in such a way that current reads to another, it has been increased by another 1 ampere. So another 1 ampere, and note down the readings W1, W2, current, voltage, F1 and F2. So like this, the step will be carried out till the rated current, till by varying the F1 and F2 till the rated current. By at least 6.5 amperes you can stop this conduction. So after that we need to unload the motor. Unload the motor. This we have to unload it and we have to switch off the software. So now let's go on to the setup where we are going to conduct this experiment. This is where we are going to conduct the experiment of load test on a three-phase induction motor. In this setup, you can see that the specification what I have discussed is a 5 induction motor, 3-phase squirrel cage induction motor, 5 HP, 415 volt, 1440 RPM. Okay, and here the DOL starter, which will be having the input terminals RYB and output terminals UVW, and the voltmeter we are going to prefer here itself on the board, and the ammeter is also be available in this board itself. And this is a part of the stator where you have to connect this U1 W2 together so that to form a delta, and here W1 and V2 should be connected before itself, and V1 and U2 should be connected before itself when you start up the experiment. And here these are the two wattmeters which we are going to use. This is a UPF wattmeter which is of the range of 10/20, so we are going to prefer the 10 amps, so it is this plate should be connected in series, and the final value of this wattmeter is 1500, and the voltage slots which we are going to prefer as a 3-phase, so we need to make use of 600 volts only. Similarly, the same specifications which we are going to see on the other side of a wattmeter, full reading is 1500, and here also the current is 10/20 amperes, so we are going to connect this in series, and the voltage slot which are going to prefer is 600 volts. So now let's move on to the theoretical circuit. So wherein we are going to start off the connections. Before the starting this connections, we will join these LEDs at the corner so that it forms a delta T. Here you can see that we have connected to form a delta type, so that is U1 W2 is connected, and V2 and W1 is connected, and as well as V1 and U2 is being connected. And also in addition, we can also complete the work, that is MC should be shorted together of our two wattmeters. Now we'll start with the further the connections, the rest of the connection. So in this case, the R is being connected to the input of a dual starter, Y is connected to input of a dual starter, B is connected to the input of dual starter. So you can take up the color code of the wire with the respective and connect it directly to this respective places, R to R, Y to Y, and B to B. Then next we are left out with the output of a dual starter. In the output of a dual starter, the R can be connected directly to the wattmeter M. So here instead of R on the board, it is written as U. It's one of the same. So we can directly connect it to the on one of the wattmeter, which is going to read as W1. Okay, so we have completed this. MC is already shorted. Next, L of this is being connected to the A1 and that is L is of the one of the wattmeter is being connected to the one end of this delta winding. And next part is the Y of the output of a dual starter should be connected to the one end of the ammeter. The other end of this ammeter should be connected to the A1, A2 and B1 where it has been shorted. So we have connected this part. Similarly, the B phase of the output of a dual starter should be connected to the M. Here, instead of B, it is written as W. It is one or the same.
So we completed the V connection should be connected to the M. Then the L of this should be connected to the other end of this delta type. So we can connect it to this part to here. Then next we have left out with the B and B, that is 600 and 600 of the two wattmeter slots should be connected together. So we have to make use of the 600 should be connected back to the 600 slot of the another wattmeter. And also we can see that one more correction, this 600 should also be connected back to the A2 and B1. So you can take up one more wire which should be in together being connected to this slot. So that should be connected back to the A2 and B1. Now we have left out with the voltmeter. So that voltmeter should be connected across these two points where A1 and C2 is sorted and A2 and B1. So you can include that voltmeter which should be connected at this point and the other voltmeter which should be connected at this point. So this is how we have completed the connections. Now let's conduct the experiment. Before that, this F1 and F2 should be loosened. Now let us switch on the supply by switching on the device starter. Now we can see the speed, voltage and the ammeter reading. But here the wattmeter, the W1 is going to kick back. So what we have to do? The C and V connection should be interchanged. So we have to switch off and we can interchange the C and V connections. So let us interchange the C and V connections of the first wattmeter. Interchanging the C and V connections of W1, let us switch on the supply.